Not from Leicester, not from Kettering, and not from Northampton. Live from Market Harborough, this is 95.1 HFM.
HFM weather in association with the new South Leicestershire Learning Innovation Centre. New location, new ways of learning, new experience for you. For more information, telephone free on 0800 731 6723.
Good morning, this is David Wortley on HFM Interactive, the Radio with Pictures show. Got a great show lined up for you today. Thank you to Richard Garvey for his excellent show between midnight and 6 o'clock. Today's weather, heavy thundery rain in some parts with scattered showers elsewhere in the morning.
David Wortley on HFM.
Good morning, it's HFM Interactive, the Radio with Pictures show. We're going to be talking about information communications technology, democracy, community engagement and gender. If you think that's a little bit heavy for this time in the morning, stay with us because I've got some great guests with some very interesting stories to tell you. So what is HFM Interactive? Well, it's a breakfast radio chat show with guests from all over the world. I was doing a little check this morning. We've actually got 50 international guests and local guests from around the globe all lined up to share their expertise with you. It's a virtual meeting place. Every day, people have been coming together on the web via www.hcln.net/HFM to interact with each other, share their ideas and experiences. It's a combination of radio and pictures, something quite unique. It's an international conference. We've got these guest speakers from around the globe, some of the leading experts from all parts of the earth. And it's a journey into the information society. We're trying to give you an insight of what the new millennium is going to be like. So give you a chance to share your views and experiences. And it's a world first for Harborough. It's all of these things. And the inspiration behind this is Thomas Cook. Thomas Cook, who was living in Harborough 1841, when he had the vision and the inspiration for the travel industry that we know today. In those days, in 1841, he was living through a communications revolution, much like the one we're living through today. Yesterday's railway network is like today's internet. What he did was to make that communications revolution, that new network technology, affordable and accessible. It gave it mass appeal and he brought a vision to the industry. So each day we're giving you a new insight into the Thomas Cook story. We're going to be having a bit of a quiz at the end of the series of this 3-week series of 15 breakfast programs. We're telling you a little bit about Thomas Cook every day. And this is an extract from the Thomas Cook story. Remember, make a note of these facts because we're going to be having a quiz next Friday and there'll be prizes to be won. So this is what Thomas Cook said in 1849. There being no cessation of rain when the train had reached Darlington, Mr. Cook, the manager of the trip, whose attention to the comfort of the passengers, it is only to doing justice to say deserved much praise, applied for a covered carriage for those who had been unfortunate enough to become the occupant of the Midland Open Ones. This was one of his first major excursions up to Scotland. And in those days, they didn't have covered carriages, they had open carriages, and he was unfortunate enough to be pouring down with rain. So 1849, July the 28th, the excursion to Scotland. Remember that story because we're going to be asking questions at the end of this series. We're broadcasting to you live from Innovation House. If you are logged on to www.hcln.net/HFM, you'll be able to see a picture of Innovation House. This is the home of the South Leicestershire Learning and Innovation Centre. It's a community, media and lifelong learning centre. This is the place to go if you want to learn about information communication technology and a range of other activities. On a programme last week we had an interview with a lady who's going to be looking after the therapy suite. So if you want to learn about massage, this is the place to come. If you want to learn about information communication technology, this is the place to come. So, how does HFM Interactive work? Well, you're listening on a 95.1 FM. The broadcast is going out to you live. And you can log on to the internet, into our virtual meeting place, and you'll be able to listen to the programme and see the images that I'm seeing on my computer screen. And around the world, we've got people logged on. Sue Webb logged on in Coventry. Shortly, Dr. Chitney's going to be logged on from India. They're listening to this programme, and they're also logging in and interacting with each other. We're going to be having prizes, just a reminder of what those prizes are. There's going to be an Back to the Future e-certificate for every completed registration form. Everyone who joins this program will have one of those certificates. There'll be a prize for phone-in questions and text questions, prizes for the oldest and youngest people logging in. There'll be that Thomas Cook quiz prize, a prize for the person logging on from furthest away, and a prize for the best web tip and the most innovative use of information communications technology. Don't forget, outside of this program, you can always ring the station on 01858 464 666. Share your experiences with us. Do you think we're entering a brave new world? Do you think information communication technology is going to be of great benefit? Is it already of benefit to you? Let us know your experiences. Dial in and the message will get through. So, we're talking about how information communications technology is going to shape our future. We're covering all sorts of aspects of information communication technology. We've already talked about empowerment. We've talked about usability of technology. We've talked about innovation and how information communication technology can help us to innovate. We've talked about community media. We've had an interview with Paula Draper talking about her Silent Winds project, and Bob Bridges, the Hollywood special effects technician living here right in Harborough, telling us about his work on the Harry Potter film. We've had guests from London and around the globe talking about social entrepreneurs. Today we're going to be talking about a brand new topic we'll come to shortly. So on this journey round the information society, we've been to several places around the globe. We've been to Washington State. We've been to San Diego. We've been to the Arctic Circle. We've been to Minneapolis yesterday. We've been to the UK, of course. We've been to Finland earlier in this week. We've been to Germany. And we've been over to Australia to interview some of our special guests. Our furthest location, our most remote part of the globe, is the Arctic Circle and a little place called Arviat, where George Lessard joined us. George Lessard's involved in community education in the Arctic Circle, and he logged on to this site, www.hcln.net/HFM, from the Arctic Circle, courtesy of a mobile telephone and a satellite link. So, highlights on this tour to date. We've had a daily Madewell sheep watch from Claire in Madewell. She's over in Ireland at the moment, unfortunately not able to be with us, but she'll be back next week. We've listened to Sam Swaby in Granby Island, down there in Plymouth, talking about their experiences with community technology. Paula Draper sharing the experience of a lady who's been through breast cancer and come through it the other side. Great inspiration to everyone. She's been talking about the launch of her video, the Silent Wings video. We've had Ahmed Chakir over there in Berlin talking about his village and discovering through the internet that it was the starting place for Jason and the Argonauts when they set off in search of the Golden Fleece. We listened to Venu Duper and Andrew Mawson OBE talking about social entrepreneurs and the impact that they can have on society. We had our own ex-BBC cameraman from Lebanon, Steve Kokain, telling us some about the stories of his camera work on programmes like EastEnders and Doctor Who. And if you remember, he was the one who told us about the filming that he was doing of a pop show live on television and how ABBA fell off the back of the lift. Great story, that one. We've had Deborah Amidon over there in Boston, Massachusetts, one of the leading experts on innovation, talking about her Intervation program. And last week, on Friday, we connected to the British High Commissioner over there in Belize. He was an old school chum of mine from Boston in Lincolnshire. We were joined by Philippa Ryan, head of the Innovation Unit at East Midlands Development Agency. And we had our very own Boston Tea Party, including singing the school song in Latin over the air. We've had Bob Bridges telling us about video stories, how he was pushing Christopher Reeves around during the making of Superman 1. We had Professor Ramus Suomi in Finland earlier this week. He was talking about his research into the railways and drawing parallels between the railways and the internet. Yesterday we had Phil Solo in the studio. Got a great project over there in Leicester, Takeover Radio, a full-time radio station which is completely run and managed by children. He was telling us how the kids interviewed the presenters for their programmes, interviewed something like 60 presenters and narrowed it down to three. Three people they trusted to put their programme content in the hands of the kids. So we went over to Ken Young over in Melbourne. He was talking to us on his mobile phone in Melbourne. He's over there preparing for another international conference on community technology projects. And he was telling about some of the work they're doing there on community radio and how kids from all around Victoria State in remote rural locations will be preparing content for that program ready for broadcast over the internet. Before we move into the programme, I just want to share with you one or two statistics. We've had this hcln.net website for about a month now, and so far, during the month of May, we had 35,000 hits. Quite an achievement. And in analysing that information, looking at the information this morning, looking at where these hits came from, we can see that, quite remarkably, 72% of people logging into the hcln.net site came from the USA. So we're reaching a global audience. Well, on today's programme, fairly shortly we'll be going over to Sue Webb, who's over there in Coventry, waiting to talk to us about her experiences with the Coventry and Warwickshire community website. And she's also now working for Community Development Foundation. She's going to be talking about their work on information communication technology and women. We'll be going over to India to talk to Dr. Suma Titnis. She's retired now, but she's had a great deal of experience in women's issues and democracy. She's going to be talking to us about what life is like in India at the present time. We hope also, sometime during today's programme, to be able to go over to Stockholm, where Jayati Parikka is at a conference on democracy, women and work, and information communication technology. So we've got a great programme lined up. So if you want to join in this programme, remember the number. It's 0800 917 2617. Dial into that number. You'll be brought in. You'll be able to ask questions of our guests. You'll be able to tell us some of your experiences with information communications technology. So, whilst we're waiting to move on, just a little bit of music from Gloria Gaynor. I Will Survive.
You're not welcome anymore. Weren't you the one who tried to hurt me with goodbye? That was Gloria Gaynor and I Will Survive. Back onto the web now. Remember, log on to www.hcln.net/HFM. I'm going to be talking about ICT and a range of issues. We're going to be talking about how information communications technology is going to affect democracy. We're going to be examining whether these kind of technologies can engage communities. Can we get more of an involvement from people in shaping their futures? We're going to be talking about how information communication technologies affect women and work. I'm throwing myself into the lion den this morning. We're going to be talking to some ladies who will be able to give us their views of how information communication technology is affecting their lives and the likely impact that will have on society. So we're going to be looking at how all of these things will affect our lives in the future. So how will information communications technology affect democracy? I know that over in Germany we've been joined by Thomas Schauer. We're going to bring him into the conversation fairly shortly. I'm sure he'll be able to give us some views and opinions on ICT and democracy. So stay on the line, Thomas. We'll be with you shortly. We've got a new phenomenon here in the UK. It's a pop idol phenomenon. There's a number of programmes where ordinary people have got the opportunity for fame and fortune by being auditioned for programmes like Pop Idols and This Is My Moment. Within Leicestershire, we have our very own pop idol. It's a man who won £180,000 on a dial-in programme, Adam Watkiss. Friend of mine, he auditioned for the programme, he sang live in front of audience of millions, and he netted £180,000 because over 360,000 people dialed in to vote for him. We're getting more people phoning in on these types of programmes than we get voting for our politicians. Is this likely to be a trend for the future? What can we learn from it? And what can information communication technology do to help in the democratic process? Can information communication technology engage communities? Well, we've got a lady on the programme today who's got a lot of expertise in this area, Sue Webb. She was responsible largely for the Coventry and Warwickshire Network community website, owned, managed and for local people in the Coventry and Warwickshire district. She's going to be talking about her experiences in developing that website, how she engaged local people, the kind of projects that she used to get people's attention and give them a chance to express themselves via the web. We're going to be talking about information communication technology and women and work. It's a revolution. We're used to, in my time over the years, seeing working commercial organisations, seeing banks of typists, ladies operating word processors. They were the first into this game, really, with word processors and now computers doing a whole range of activities. Does this give women a new power in this brand new age, or are there other factors we need to take into account? We're going to be talking to Sue and Suma Chitnis about these issues. How will information communications technology shape society? Now, if you're lucky enough to be logged on to www.hcln.net/HFM, you'll see a wonderful picture of a man in a pinafore. Are we all becoming house husbands? Is this the fate of man? Or will the traditional gender power battle be played out on the internet? What's going to happen to society? Will it change our lives? And how will it change our lives? We're going to be talking about that very shortly. So remember, if you've got any questions on today's programme, it's 0800 917 2617, or if you're abroad, it's 496074 864 802. So let's get right on with the programme. And at this stage, I'd like to bring in Thomas Schauer. I know he's joined us this morning from Germany. He's not logged onto the internet, but he's waiting there on the end of the line. Thomas, how are you?
I'm fine, but our internet is not.
Oh, your internet's not fine.
seems that we have no internet this morning. I do not know why yet, but maybe there has a fallout of electricity.
A fallout of electricity. Yes, that's an interesting phrase. Well, it was a great pleasure to have you on the programme last week, Thomas. I know you're not a particular football fan, and as you said in your message to me, the only way that you know that there is any World Cup activity is when the streets are empty. But there's a big match on today. It's Germany against Ireland. It's over at lunchtime in the UK, so I'm going to be watching that programme. So, Thomas, I'm just going to go onto the internet and see if I can find your profile there. Just bring it up on the screen so that those people who are logged onto the internet will be able to recall a little bit of information about you. So, Thomas, just tell us a little bit about yourself and your activities.
I'm working in Ulm at the Research Institute for Applied Knowledge Processing, which is an institute which, on the one hand, develop software, for example, for environmental information systems, for knowledge management and so on, and which on the other hand also makes technology impact assessment.
Right.
And that's the area where I'm working in.
So you're really in an ideal position, really, to give us the benefit of your knowledge about the impact of information communications technology in this area. Have you got any views on how ICT is going to affect democracy?
Yes, I think with respect to discussion and distribution of opinions, especially distribution of opinions of minorities, there is a big advance by information technology. Where I see risk is if we introduce too fast some election procedures via the internet. Yeah, it may happen, and it has already happened.
Yes,
that there is cheating, that the system does not function.
Right.
And in this case, the image of the internet gets a damage which cannot be repaired easily.
Right. So you think there's a danger of us rushing far headlong into e-democracy because of the potential for abuse?
Yes. And as we know from the past, there happen always the things which we did not expect to happen.
What sort of things are you talking about?
Yeah, for example, you know, these meetings of the economic and political leaders in Davos.
Yes, in Davos, yeah.
It was, for example, possible to access the personal data, including credit card numbers, including mobile phone numbers, of all the people, including Yasser Arafat, Mr. Sharon, and so on.
Right.
Yeah, so there are always holes. Or with respect to voting procedures, the Green Party in Germany tried to arrange voting on their convent, and it was a complete failure. The whole event had to be repeated.
Right. This was actually electronic voting at the event. Did it involve people remotely?
Yes, it was electronic voting at the event, and it did not function. There were wrong results.
And why was that?
Oh, it was not clear.
Right. Yeah,
but it turned out that it had to be repeated. So if these things happen, if technology is introduced in an unripe state, the delay of the introduction will be bigger than the delay which would be created if we wait until we have better technology.
Right, so your view would be that we should wait until the technology is a little bit more secure.
Yes, security first.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'd just like to just touch on that point and explore that a little bit further, because as you know, that there are some developments going on with ICANN, which is an organisation which is designed to set policies for the internet on a worldwide basis, intended to be an extremely democratic process. We've got IP version 6 coming down the line, which will not only provide the internet with many billions more of web addresses to provide sufficient capacity, but will also have some implications for personal privacy. Now, I don't know what your views on this are. What's your attitude to the internet and privacy as far as democracy is concerned?
I think I'm following what is going on. I can a little bit skeptically. We had a very advanced e-democracy there, when the board of directors was elected. Yeah.
Yeah.
And presently they are discussing of finishing this experiment and not repeating these elections.
Right. So.
Of course, there were problems with this election because I think in Europe and Northern America there were thousands of people participating in the election, and in Africa there were, I think, 18.
Yes.
Yeah, on the whole continent. So there is a big problem with the minorities who have bad internet access being represented adequately. But nevertheless, I think this experiment should be continued.
Yes.
Because also with the present construction of ICANN, with the participation of industry, government and the non-governmental sector on a rather equal base, we have a progress compared to other areas of politics.
Yeah. Well, it's a very interesting area. I know we're having some experiments here in the UK in e-democracy, and I'm very familiar with the work of Stephen Clift over in Minneapolis. In many ways, he's one of the founders of e-democracy. Can I just move on to the impact of ICT and women, Thomas? Do you have any views, opinions of the way in which information communication technology affects gender issues?
In the beginning of the internet, the women were disadvantaged. They had less access. And in many countries, they still have statistically less access to the internet. Maybe this is correlated to less technical interest, which has, of course, nothing to do with talent, but with education.
Yeah.
But in most countries, the situation is changing now. We got, for example, from Russia the information that the figures are almost equal, and also in Germany the number of male and female servers are practically equal in the younger generation. Yeah? There are still larger differences in the elder generation.
Yeah. So things are changing, and I've not looked at the figures recently, but it seems that we're moving much towards a pretty much a 50-50 split in terms of internet users. Do you think this will change the balance of power at all? Are women better equipped to use information communication technology than men are?
Okay, scientists say women are more talented to do many things at the same time.
Yes.
And if you consider how often you have to do that at the internet, they may have an advantage.
Yes. So, in other words, women may have latent skills, or not even latent, very apparent skills, which equip them better to use these technologies than men.
Maybe, yes.
Yeah. Well, just on that point, very quickly, because I want to move on to Sue very shortly. I was over in Germany a couple of weeks ago at a conference in Berchtesgaden, and there was some research presented by a lady scientist. I think she was from Finland, and some of the results are quite surprising because she was looking at the behaviour of mixed group of men and women in collaboration situations, and she had control groups who were collaborating face to face, and she had other groups who were collaborating via virtual communities. And my first impression would have been that women, because they generally more caring and more proactive, would have been able to have influenced the direction of these virtual communities better than men. But in fact, that did not prove to be the case. Also, the research would indicate, but it's certainly something to that needs research in more detail. Well, thank you very much for joining us, Thomas. It's a great pleasure to have you on the program again. Please continue to join us whenever you have got the time or there's a particular subject that interests you. We're going to be going over to Sue Webb in just a moment, and whilst we move towards that, I'm just going to play a bit of music. music that Sue asked me as a request. It's Eva Cassidy and Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Okay, Sue, that was Eva Cassidy, especially for you. That song is one of my favourites. I've played the part of the Tin Man in The Wizard of Oz. It's a great moral story. In fact, I was thinking of having that as a theme at the end of all of my programmes. As Dorothy gets back to Kansas, she says to say, "No, there's no place like home. There's no place like home. There's no place like home." It's all about talent in your own backyard, discovering it, recognising it, and empowering it. Sue, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
Ah, good morning. How are you this morning?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Can you see your picture up on the screen there?
Unfortunately, yes.
Well, it's great to have you on the programme, Sue. Great to have you on the programme. We've had dealings over the years on a variety of community technology issues, and I know and I respect the experience that you've got. I want to talk to you to begin with. I want you to just tell us a little bit about the CWN project.
Commentary and Warwickshire Network was started by someone called Chris Studman, who was part of an environmental network in Coventry, and his interest was to try and share information within an environmental grouping. In the early days, internet and email communications, whereby the group could communicate very quickly with each other. And that what happened after that was community groups suggested that they too would like information and to be connected, and the whole thing exploded. So it went from it went from you know, 10 pages of information to probably something like 10,000 pages of information on the site now, ranging from everything from what's on at the cinema to news stories to history pages to birth, deaths and marriages, and a very popular section called Find a School Friend, so that if you went to school in Coventry, you can search the site and leave messages for anybody else that you may have been at school with, or look for them. So it's an interesting way of doing things. It's actually communities providing the information rather than having it delivered to them.
So the people who actually design the web pages, they're not employed by an organisation to keep this site up to date. It's ordinary people in the community. Is that correct?
Well, not strictly true. In the early days, that was the case. But CWN is hosted by Coventry Internet Development, and that is a business.
Yes.
In the early days, it was very much about community information, and it's the actual information that is dropped into templates, so it is community-led information.
Yes, so it's community-led information. You have community-based journalists who are creating content. So what do you think about information communication technology and democracy? Do you think we've got potential to improve the democratic process, or are we so used to getting, spoon-fed with digital television that we're losing interest in local affairs?
I think there are tensions there. I'm always sceptical about how people use it. Now, people will use these technologies for whatever interests them. And if they're interested in politics and democracy, they will then find a way of engagement. But actually, you know, if you're working in communities, you recognise that you have to sort of work with a person around what they're particularly interested in. Think about in Coventry. If you're working in an Irish community, for example, how to engage someone with the technology is to find out what their particular interest is, and it may just be, you know, what the football team is doing back home.
Yes.
Back home in Ireland or wherever. The same with, you know, the Asian communities. It's whatever a particular group is interested in or a particular person is interested in. How we expand that to sharing information and using it in the democratic process is a big challenge. One of the things that we've tried to do online consultations around particular issues that affect people right on their doorstep, it's the community activists that get involved. It's those that are actually active anyway.
Yes.
And it's very difficult, you know, for people to engage with the technology around burning issues, because sometimes the technology itself is a hurdle.
Right, yeah. Carry on.
I was going to say, if you're comfortable with the technology and you're actually, it's an issue that you're also interested in, perhaps something that's happening on your doorstep or something in your local council, then you'll probably use it. But as for using it, you know, nationally in a democratic process, it's those that have the education and the skills and are using it anyway, I think, that will benefit the most at this point.
Right. So do you see, though, I mean, you're talking about the Find a School Friend part of the Coventry and Warwickshire site. Have you found that that's engaged people who might otherwise have had an interest in using the computer and the internet?
Yes, because that's what I was talking about. It's actually what they're interested in. And when we've demonstrated this at events, you know, during festivals, if you stood in a marquee with demonstrating the use of the web in a community context, what people want to do is find out where their school is and remember the people they went to school with, remember the headmaster, remember the teachers, remember those days, or perhaps even forget sometimes. But it's making those connections that makes it real. And so, for example, the excitement on somebody's face when they see a name that they haven't thought of for 20 or 30 or 40 years, and the fact that they can now communicate with them. And it may be, you know, that they hardly knew them, or actually that they knew them quite well, but it's that human contact that the technology has enabled them to recognise and remember that seems to be the strength.
I don't think you joined us last Friday when I'd use a similar kind of website to find out if there are any of my old contemporary school pals logged onto the internet who would join us on a programme, because we had Deborah Amid on from Boston, Massachusetts, so I thought it would be nice to have a Boston theme to the programme. So well, I used something like the Find a Friend school website and discovered somebody who was at school with me is now British High Commissioner in Belize. And through the internet, I was able to turn up some old school photographs, including a picture of me at school prize day in 1961, and we shared these pictures over the internet, and we finished up singing the school song in Latin in duet over this programme, which I'm sure was of little interest to a lot of people listening to today's programme, but it was, as you say, it was something that was of interest, and it does bring people together. One of the ideas that we had for this programme was to perhaps get in touch with Martin Johnson and have a Martin Johnson School Day programme, at which we could get some of his old contemporary pals logged onto the web and using this virtual classroom technology to be able to share pictures and stories about kids and teachers in school in those days. Okay, so let's move on quickly to your current work. Who is it you're working for now?
I manage a project called Women Connect. It's funded by the Community Fund, but it's based within the Community Development Foundation in London.
Yes.
Although I also work out of Leicester some days.
Yes.
It's about connecting women onto the web, that's both with physical access and equipment, but also working with them around capacity building issues and community development, so that creating a network so that groups can communicate with each other, but also addressing particular interests that women may have, you know, such as groups may be campaigning for domestic violence, and giving such groups a voice to plug into the policy, so that, you know, government can hear the needs and using the technology.
So do you think there are any particular issues or technology or hurdles which or barriers which women have that you don't find in men's use of the internet?
I think men are probably far more comfortable with using the technology. So that barrier in itself is down for men, but not obviously all men.
Yes.
I think women come at times with a nervousness, but as you said earlier on, you know, there is a long history of women using the technology for word processing, etc. But the more creative elements, so that they can have a voice, so that they can engage and take part in consultations, that they can actually network with other women across the globe around particular issues. These are things that women often need support in doing, because it's not something that you can naturally do, thinking about how can we network with a group, what do we say, how do we communicate, what are the kind of questions that I want to ask, you know, someone that's working perhaps in India or Russia.
Yes.
Around the issues that I'm interested in.
Yes.
And so we're doing some, well, not so much under Women Connect, but under other projects that I've worked on. You know, it's about building confidence and respecting each other in the environment in which we work.
So if there are any ladies in Harborough who maybe are in this position where they're a little bit nervous about using the technology, want to find out more, think maybe that there is some potential for them in helping them in their lives, how can ladies in Harborough get in touch with Women Connect, Sue?
Well,
I
think you put the web address up there. It's www.womenconnect.org.uk.
Yes.
And if they have email, they can email us at info@womenconnect.org.uk, or alternatively they can call us on 020-7226-5375. We have some funding to put women's groups online. We also have some funding to work around to put some workshops on across the UK, regional workshops, so that people can get training and support. So that's a starting place. But I think there's nothing better than actually starting on your doorstep, and I believe you have an ICT centre that you're involved with.
Yes, we're here at Innovation House this morning, broadcasting to live on 95.1. Innovation House is the home of the South Leicestershire Learning and Innovation Centre, which is a government-funded project which will provide training for people wanting to get into the internet, for whether it's for business purposes or just general interest. So yes, people can come here and do some training. But I know also we have in Harborough, we have women who are actively involved in a number of community issues, and one that springs to mind immediately is a particular problem with youth and drugs that we have here in Harborough. I know there are a number of women who are very active in campaigning for that. So would it be possible for them to contact women connect to discuss how technology might help them and maybe get some funding for a seminar?
Yes, it's something that wouldn't be funding for them to put on the seminar. We could actually work with them around
yes.
the issues that they wanted to raise. And also equipment. So, yeah, do tell them to get in contact with us.
Okay, so Sue Webb, if you are in that position, if you're a lady, you want to get into to technology, there will be facilities here for training. But as Sue says, there is a special organisation designed there to support you. If you want to contact the station outside of the this programme, it's 01858 464 666. So call in, give us your details, and I'll make the connection with Sue Webb over there in Coventry at the moment, working for Community Development Foundation. Well, thank you very much for joining us this morning, Sue. We're going to be going over to India very shortly. Before I play a little bit of music, have you got any concluding remarks that you would like to make?
I think what you're doing is exciting because it's an opportunity for people that, you know, don't always speak on the radio to get their message across, but also because you're actually recording it, we can come back to it in our own time, and that's the beauty of the web.
Absolutely.
Is that, you know, you don't have to hear it live, but the information is there and you can go back to it, and it's a resource. So well done, David.
Thank you very much, Sue. And your check will be in the post.
Oh, right, okay.
Okay, Sue, thanks again. Before we go over to Suma Chidnis in India, there's just a little bit of music now as an introduction. Dr. Chidnis, are you with us?
Right here.
Ah, good morning. Well, is it still morning with you in India?
Yes, it's 25 past 11.
25 past 11. And what's the weather like over there?
Hot, sunny.
Well, it's pretty much like that here in the UK, although we're expecting some heavy thundery rain later on today. Thank you so much for joining us on the programme. I know we only made contact with each other yesterday, and it was a guest on the programme last week, Professor Rao, who put me in touch with you, and I'm delighted to have you on the programme. Before we move on to information communication technology, perhaps I could just ask you what things are like in India at the moment, because we're aware from the news that there are problems over Kashmir with Pakistan. How is that affecting ordinary Indian people?
Well, if I sum it up in two words, it's worrisome uncertainty.
Right, so it's causing a lot of nervousness.
I don't know how many people are really aware of what is happening. You know, there is a kind of bliss in ignorance, and the mass of the Indian population is uneducated and therefore is not as aware of political issues as we would be in a democracy if people were educated. But generally there is a fear of war. People believe that war will not happen, that the clouds will have come and they will go. But it's the uncertainty that bothers. And I think educated Indians are worried that the Kashmir issue might get converted into a communal issue. And that is something that nobody wants.
No, absolutely correct.
Because the Hindus and Muslims are all basically Indians.
Yes, yes.
And they're worried that the frenzy could turn into something. But I don't think they really believe that a war will happen.
Do you think that information communication technology is something which can break down barriers between communities, or is it something that can actually make those divisions worse? I'm not quite sure myself on this. What's your view?
I think it depends on what kind of information is communicated. The trouble is that information technology is very little used, very exclusively used. In India, only a small fraction of the population has access to internet. And sometimes over the last few years, one has been worried about the kind of information, the kind of messages that are sent on the internet. Do you get me? I mean,
yes.
Militant groups, terrorist groups.
Yes.
Have more time to use technology for subversive purposes than normal people have to use it for sustenance.
Absolutely right. And I think this
restoring sanity.
Carry on.
Yeah, but on the other hand, because of the internet, people like journalists and so on, I mean, they have better access to information, and they are providing more informed statements through the media than would normally happen. So I think one major gain from information technology is that those who communicate with people have better access to wider information.
Yes, we're hoping to have Frederick Noronha on the program. Are you familiar with him? He's a journalist in Asia.
With whom?
Frederick Noronha.
Is that Noronha, a name? Yes.
Yeah. Yes. I'm expecting him on the program.
He's from Bombay too, isn't he?
That's correct. He is, and he's.
I know him slightly.
Yeah, he's involved with the Bites for All organisation,
yes.
And we've done some fantastic work in India.
Yes.
We in the UK and Europe and in the States as well. We're all familiar with the how the software industry has developed in India. It really has been, from my perspective, a transformation in the Indian economy. How do you see that from your perspective? Do you see it as a positive thing that Indian expertise is being exported all over the world, or do you see it as a form of colonialism?
No, absolutely positive. Indians have a gift for numbers, and they have discovered a gift for information technology, and success in that field has brought Indians a tremendous confidence. So there is in the country a very positive feeling about India's success in the information technology.
Well certainly my understanding of it is, and my experience of it is, that there's a great deal of technical expertise in India, and I think as a government strategy for developing the economy, India is establishing itself as, if you like, having a brand identity for very strong ICT skills, and all credit to those involved for developing, putting that policy in place. Could I just ask you about ICT and women now, and what's happening in India, and the likely impact that's likely to have on women's issues there?
Okay, I must again start with the statement that only a very, very small sector of the Indian population has access to information technology. The next thing is that much of it is used for business and for work, and very little for browsing around. It's only if you have home computers that you can use information technology more liberally. You can't browse in the office.
Right.
But having said that, there are several ways in which information technology has made a big difference. women's groups, groups working with women, have direct access to what's happening in the world. And I think sharing of violence, of discrimination, information on violence and discrimination, and above all sharing how this has been dealt with worldwide, has helped activists who work on behalf of women enormously in India. They have access worldwide to others who work in the field. I think that another area where information technology mattered in the information technology is used a lot in fields like agriculture.
Yes, and
yes. I mean, I have no first-hand information, but I have looked at programs made, for instance, Foundation develops programs in agriculture, in fisheries.
Interrupt you, but we're coming up to the hour now for the news, so thank you very much for joining us.
This is HFM.
A car bomb has exploded. It went off next to a bus which burst into flames during the morning rush hour. Reporter in Jerusalem, David, not far.
Fuller, it's a strip of road that has been attacked numerous occasions during the last couple of years of the incident.
Is offering